What went wrong? This is a question I want to answer for you guys in this live update video. I will briefly talk about what happened in the World Championship in Japan and why Mountain Sea Sport got knocked out so early in the group stage. I'm also going to answer a question that a lot of people asked me. Did Nouns really disband? And after that, I'm gonna show you a little bit how I spend my time at Worlds and afterwards during Japan because I took a vacation for 2 weeks. You also may have noticed that my room is a bit different and I have a lot of stuff going on. I'm going to answer this question as well, and then I will tell you guys what I will do in the off-season of Pokemon Unite and what I will do in the future with this channel or as a content creator in general. I'm keeping my answers a bit short in this video because it's a live update video, but I'm going to make dedicated videos towards some of the questions like what I did in Japan afterwards. In my previous videos, I only showed you guys what I did in the bootcamp from Japan with Nouns Esports. Now we are going to talk about what happened in the group stage in the World Championship 2023 and how did Nouns Esports get knocked out so early in day one. Let's get into it. These are the group stage and results. Here you can see group A, group B, group C, group D, group D, etc. And most importantly, we're going to look at group B and why Nouns Esports didn't make it out of groups, even though it was a 3-man 2-1 tie. The way we will do it is I will show you parts of the games and drafts, and then I will show you some insights from the team and knowledge we had going into the game. I'm going to keep the games against Exoclan a bit shorter because they haven't been the deciding factor why we lost in the group stage. For the first draft against Exoclan, Exoclan banned Leafeon and we banned Lapras. They picked Umbreon, we picked Inteleon Hooper, they picked Mew Blastoise, we picked Trevenant and Urshifu, and then they picked Guardian Zacian. And then we picked Talonflame, because Talonflame is good against Double Mage. He can fly over Umbreon's mean look, and he's pretty annoying in general. First game was pretty straightforward. We have been ahead the entire game with points. They catched up in levels, but we catched the Mew off guard in the team fight and decided to flip it. And this is also how you can win games. If people are not coming to the middle and no one is paying attention to it and you whip it fast enough, you can catch people off guard and win a game like this. The second game was also pretty straightforward. Arisa notices that the Hoopa is going to ultimate, and then he catched two people coming out of the Hoopa portal with his ultimate, and we team wiped them, secured the Rayquaza, and we secured our first best of three. So why did Nouns Esports not make it out of groups after such a good start? The answer lies in the draft against RRQ. From our research against RRQ, we noticed that RRQ is playing a lot of Blastoise and Zacian. Blastoise defender is a really good defender, and we noticed that Leafeon is really good in extending the lead. So what we wanted to do is ban Lapras and pick Blastoise away from them and pick the Leafeon. So they first picked Umbreon and we picked Blastoise and Leafeon. Then they countered with Hoopa and Zacian and we picked Eldegoss and Urshifu. So from our research, we noticed that Blue Urshifu is a really good character against almost every team. And Blue Urshifu is a really strong character. We played it a lot in scrims and it was working a lot. Against RRQ specifically, we wanted to play Blue Urshifu and Leafeon to extend the early game lead and win the game by extending the early game lead to the mid game and late game. Now that I explained the thought process behind the plan, I will explain you what happened like in the draft. So the day before Worlds, we prepared our games with RRQ, Exoclan and Orangutan. And against RRQ, we wanted to play Water Bear specifically. We discussed it and we said why we shouldn't play Red Bear. I decided to play Red Bear at Worlds because I didn't really get why I should play Water Bear against an Umbreon, Zacian, A9 and the Zoroark. Because it, like, every one of them is countering me really hard. But there wasn't the point of playing Water Bear. Water Bear is a really good character. It was really good at Worlds. And we just wanted to play it to extend the early game lead. And then let the team carry. While the Water Bear just keeps farming and getting level. This is what I didn't understand. And that's why our game plan, this is RRQ specifically, didn't work as planned. Since I played Red Bear and then we didn't really stick to the plan. Sending the Leafeon bot lane with the Blastoise and extending the early game lead. We sent a Leafeon top lane and picked Mew as an attacker. The first game against RRQ wasn't even that bad. We were almost even in points, even in level, and overall it was a fine team fight. Texas was scoring points after the team fight ended and RRQ decided to flip it. During the flip, we weren't sure if we were ahead or not, so we decided to flip with them. RRQ was playing it really well because they waited for me to go inside and then they killed me and secured the Rayquaza. I remember Sixx was pretty upset because he knew we were ahead and we just needed to protect the points. And this is how we lost the first game of the best of three. Sadly, after it didn't get better. In the second draft, we were first pick and we banned Hoopa because we knew that the support is only playing Hoopa or Glyphable. But it didn't get better because I refused to play Water Bear in the second draft when I saw Umbralization, but that resulted into giving them Waterbear and Clefable, and then we panic picked Dodrio and Espeon at the end, and they decided to pick Venusaur. And Venusaur was really good into our comp. We could have saved the draft by picking Delphox, because it's good against Clefable, but because we weren't really decisive what to pick, we just picked comfort picks, which resulted into bad picks versus the enemies. The game itself wasn't that bad, we were even in levels, but the Umbreon was scoring, and we weren't really punishing him for scoring. And during the team fight, we tried to kill the Venusaur, but the Venusaur was unstoppable and he was just outstanding us, and they had a really decisive team fight and won the best of 3-0 against us. What I learned from the series is that it's important to trust in your teammates, but also trust in the game plan that you're developing. If you make a game plan, be decisive with the game plan, and just keep sticking to the game plan. Even if you lose, even if you win, as long as you have a game plan that is solid, you should be able to have a great game. But let me tell you guys, being 2-0'd at Worlds is not the best feeling. After getting 2-0'd against RRQ meant that we need to 2-0 Orangutan to make a sudden death happening or make it out of groups, because RRQ also lost against Orangutan 2-0. It puts a lot of pressure on you, especially on stage. Now we will look into the BO3 against Orangutan and see what happened. The first game against Orangutan was actually pretty straightforward. We picked Zacian as a first pick, and we banned Urshifu because we knew Shingi from Orangutan was a really good water bear, and we just banned it because it was the strongest pick. So basically, going into this draft, we said after we lost against RRQ that we just gonna first pick Zacian, pick our comfort picks, Hoopa, Trevenant, Dodrio, and Delphox, and that game went really well. Although I mentioned it went really well, it was actually pretty close. They had a point lead and we decided to flip the Rayquaza. We got the Rayquaza by Geese using the Shadow Ball and Portal with an insane play. The next game of the BO3 was the deciding factor if we make it out of groups or not, because if we 2-0 Orangutan, we will make a sudden death happen or make it out of groups. And this game was extremely important. We will go into the draft now. For the draft, we banned Urshifu and we picked Lapras Leafeon in the second pick. They first picked Inteleon and they prioritized Umbreon and Izzy a lot. We decided to play Gardevoir against them and Hoopa, and for the last pick, I was deciding to have a last pick between Dodrio and A9, and I picked A9 into a Machamp, which was not really the best decision. I could have picked Dodrio and the game could have been a bit different, but overall I think the A9 pick was fine if we had better positioning at the end. Sadly, the second game wasn't really good because of the positioning that we took. During the game, I said to my team that I don't want to take this position and that I don't want to be on top lane side as A9, because I think like A9 on top lane against a Machamp is really scary, but if I just played on pet, it would have never been a problem, because I didn't play on pet and the Machamp submissioned me onto the wall and used ultimate against me, and he was splitting up our team while Xerxes and Brav were killing the other team, and we lost because Machamp was making the game deciding play and they won the Rayquaza and won the second game. After the second game, you can see from our faces that that lose caused us to lose Worlds. If we would have 2-0'd them, we could have made it out of groups or make a sudden death happening. But because they won the second game, we already knew that we were losing and it was really hard. The third game was basically just like playing the game out and see how it goes. But we already knew that we were losing because we felt like that ExoClan is gonna lose against RRQ. So basically, if ExoClan would have won against RRQ, we would have made it out of groups. But because ExoClan lost 2-0 against RRQ as well, it was just over for us. But I will still show you guys the draft and the game against Orangutan in the game 3. So we banned Urshifu again, and then we first picked Inteleon. And for that game specifically, we just picked Slowbro attacker on top lane and Inteleon bot lane, and we played Aegislash jungle. I think Aegislash in general was a really good meta pick, but because Aegislash needs to get this level 7, it's a bit hard to play, but it worked out at the end in this game. To be honest, the Arrestus play in game 3 at the end was really, really cool. It was destroying the enemies with Inteleon liquidation, and it was really nice to watch.
Support with the big egg bomb. Adesu, he leashes away, and oh, the liquidation! And that's why liquidation is sick. And now the Blizzy gets credit. Geese is on fire. 4 players down, and it's just the Leafeon Spraggle. He can now secure this in front of the Leafeon. They take.
Xerxes secured the objective at the end, and liquidation just one-shotted Leafeon. This just shows how strong liquidation was, or still is. So even though we won the best of 3 against Orangutan at Worlds, we still didn't make it out of groups, because we got 2-0'd against RRQ. Honestly, it's pretty sad, and I was asking Adesso for a hug at the end of the game because I knew it was already over. But this is how we lost at Worlds. The question a lot of people asked me after Worlds and after Nouns disbanded and after Nouns resigned a new team What happened to Gatlu? Did Gatlu really leave Nouns? Did Gatlu get kicked out of Nouns? Why is Gatlu not in Nouns? And I'm gonna answer you this question now. After Worlds ended, Nouns posted on Twitter that today we are saying goodbye to our Pokemon Night roster, as they are deciding to go their separate ways for the upcoming season. That meant that we are not part of Nouns anymore as a team, and we disbanded as a team. I know it's shocking to hear that Nouns disbanded as a team and I'm not part of Nouns anymore. So basically we decided to go separated ways after Worlds. This year it wasn't the best performance for Nouns, and after Worlds performance we decided to disband as a team and go separated ways. As the members of Nouns, I think Geese is working on his job again, Sixties is going to make a new team or joining a team, and Broth and Tadesu joined Nouns Esports. And Blaine joined Nouns Esports as well. Blaine is a contributor for Nouns Esports, and he's part of Nouns Esports team as a sub and manager. I used to be the captain for Nouns Esports team Pokemon Unite, and I was the captain for 2 years. I know it's strange that I'm not part of Nouns anymore or the new Nouns, but I'm gonna go back to this later in the video. And I'm going to show you guys who the new members are for the new Nouns team for Broth, Adesu, and Blaine. As I told you before, Nouns Esports didn't leave Pokemon Unite. They posted some leaks about the new players that will join Nouns Esports, and part of them is Blaine, Broth, and Adesu. And the three new players are Toon, Megu, and Yutao. You can check the tweets in their Twitter accounts, Nouns Esports. Nouns Esports made a really cool video that showcased the history of our team, Nouns Esports, from 2022 to 2023. The Twitter link for that video I will put in the description below. Before we talk about what I will do in the future of Pokemon Unite, I wanted to show you guys what I did afterwards in Japan and how my Japan experience was. It's only part of the things I did in Japan because I wanted to make a dedicated video for my Japan experience. After the World Championship in Japan, we spent 2 weeks in Japan traveling across the country with my brother. We went from Yokohama to Osaka to visit the Universal Studios in Osaka. And in Osaka, we visited Universal Studios, which had Hogwarts inside, which was really, really cool. Because we saw Hogwarts in general and the train, which was pretty cool. And from Osaka, we went to an island that was called Miyashima Island. With the JR Pass, you can travel with the ferry to the Miyashima Island. In the island, you can go hiking. And we went all the way to the top, to the mountain, and get a beautiful picture like this one. From Osaka, we went to Kyoto, and in Kyoto, we visited the Fushimi Inari Shrine. And it was a really cool shrine. Afterwards, we went to the Pokemon Center. And in Japan, there have been a lot of Pokemon Centers. This Pokemon Center specifically was open for everyone. Usually, you are like waiting 1 hour ticket to visit the Pokemon Center, which was pretty weird, because this one was a pretty cool one, but they had no tickets. Our last stop was in Tokyo. In Tokyo, we went to an Oland Get Cafe, which was a really cool new experience, because in the cafe, you were able to pet an owl, and it was a really strange and weird interaction with the owl. He was just looking me in the eye, and I was petting him gently with my back of my hand. What you just saw was part of the things I did in Japan with my brother. I will make a dedicated video for the Japan experience on my YouTube channel in the future, so I hope you will look forward to it. Okay guys, before I talk about what I will do in the future of Pokemon Unite, I wanted to show you guys why my room is a bit different, why I have everything going on, and if I moved out, or if I'm still living with my parents, or what am I doing right now. Afterwards, I realized that it's really important to have a good environment. And because my environment wasn't the best, I decided to go upstairs and build my own room. My stepdad helped me a lot with building my own room and making it happen. I always ask for my own room, and I'm really happy that I'm able to share it with you guys and show you guys the progress how I built from this to this room right here. It took us a total of 2 weeks to finish the room. It was the first time I was making my own room with my stepdad, and we bought a lot of materials. It was pretty cool to watch how my dad was building up the room, measuring everything, and just putting everything together. After we had our foundation of the room with the plaster boards, we put regips on the plaster boards in the corners to make sure everything is well put together. And after the regips dried, we painted the room light gray. After we finished the room, I made a 3D model how it would look like. If you made it to the end of the video, I hope I answered some of the questions you guys had. Now we're going to talk about if I will still continue playing Pokemon Unite for the next 3 years. Since I'm not part of Nouns anymore and my team disbanded afterwards, it was pretty rough for me in the beginning. It took me a while to upload this video. Every time I was editing this video or making this video, I got a bit sad because of Worlds and what happened to my team. I decided to compete for the next 3 years and keep uploading content for my YouTube channel and live streaming on Twitch. And lately, I started doing a multi-stream with Twitch and YouTube. Currently, I'm planning on making a new team or joining a team. The offseason is still pretty long in the EU scene. I'm not sure if I'm going to be a top laner or a defender for my new team or joining a team as a sub slash coach because the offseason is still pretty long and anything can happen in the offseason. As it is right now, I'm not playing with any of my old members from Nouns. But as I mentioned earlier, things can change in the offseason and anything can happen. We just need to see how things will develop over the time. In my old team, Nouns Esports, I was the short caller and the flex pick of the team. But things have changed because I noticed that it's not good to be a top laner, jungler and attacker. That's why I decided for myself that I will be playing the top lane role or the defender role for my new team and maybe be the new short caller of the team. Afterwards, I played in a lot of tournaments like the weekly The Pump that Pump is hosting every Friday. In that tournament, I was playing with Adesso, Megu and Yutaro and Luca. But since Megu, Yutaro and Adesso are Nouns, I'm not going to play with Adesso as it is right now for the next UCS. I also participated in a lot of United Battle Lab tournaments like an NA one, the Double Trouble one. Vex, my friend from NA, invited me to the NA tournament and I played with Overlord, Vex, Kira and Yitfan. And the question was,
is it going to be so simple for it's so simple?
And that day in the tournament, Overlord was riding on my back as Lapras and we did an amazing Regulecki push with Zacian. I stole the Regulecki with the Lapras ultimate and I got a double kill as well afterwards. In the late game teamfight, I used ultimate behind them and I got a 4-man knockout with my ultimate and we team wiped them. Captain Ranks was also one of the participants in Worlds. Team Eternity 7 was really good as well and they have been participating in the United Battle Lab tournament.
Is it so simple for it so simple to make their way through?
Incredible stuff.
Jokes aside, right now I'm playing in the LFBU, which is a French league, and I joined a French team. Our team name is Justin Green Dogs. It's a French inside. I don't really get it, to be honest. But we qualified for the LFBU. We won 4 games out of the 5 games in the qualifier and managed to get the 5th seed. In the French team is Classic, Sam, Meitao and Forward, and our subs are Renz and Oni. I'm also trying to join the European League for Team Germany. Last year we managed to get top 4 and I was the captain. But this year I will participate as a player. But yeah guys, this was my life update video. I hope it answered a lot of questions for you guys and it made it clear what I will do in the future. As a content creator, I will be trying to upload more consistently, make more guides like the Zodorak video you have been asking for quite some time. In this life update video, I mentioned that I'm going to upload a video regarding to my Japan experience, so I hope you guys will look forward to it. I will try my best to upload more consistently and I hope you guys will continue to support me. If you enjoyed the video, make sure to give it a like and don't forget to subscribe to not miss any future videos like the one I was talking about earlier about my Japan experience. This was everything I wanted to tell you guys today. I will see you guys in the next video.